What does neuroscience, yoga, and psychology have to do with each other? The answer is a lot. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Mala. I'm the founder of Positive Health Solutions, where we offer you positive solutions for your physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual health. I specialize in psychotherapy, neurotherapy, and medical yoga. Welcome to my video series entitled Healing Journey, where I'll be focusing on the intersection of neuroscience, psychology, yoga, and mindfulness for impacting on healing and stress, anxiety, depression, general health, and spiritual issues, and many other similar topics. The techniques and the concepts that I'm going to share with you are powerful, and research has found them to be effective for influencing the healing of our nervous system, our emotions, and mind. These techniques and concepts have the potential to make a difference in your health and happiness. If you're new here, please make sure to hit the subscribe button. It's free, and you'll get notified of additional healing videos. So let's get started. Let's circle back to my question. What does neuroscience, yoga, and psychology have to do with each other? As I said, the answer is a lot. I've been teaching and practicing yoga for over 40 years, and I've also been studying and practicing in the field of neuroscience and psychology for a long time. These three disciplines, yoga, psychology, and neuroscience, all complement one another. And when we bring these three disciplines together, they provide us with concepts, powerful formulas for healing, and they also provide us with mapping strategies for how to navigate our way back to health and wellness. So throughout this series, I'm going to talk with you about concepts, and I'm going to provide you with specific techniques and formulas for impacting on healing and health and happiness. Today, I'm going to share with you information on the intersection of the polyvagal theory, stress, and the concept of the gunas from the yoga tradition. As I stated, these concepts I'm going to share with you provide a wonderful foundation and a springboard for you to then move into specific healing techniques. I'm going to keep everything very simple. So let's start with the polyvagal theory. Dr. Stephen Porges is the founder of the polyvagal theory, and through his research, Dr. Porges discovered something amazing. What he discovered is that there are three main neural platforms that make up the autonomic nervous system. And why is this important? It's important because once we understand that we can impact on these neural platforms, along with the wiring in our brain and on our neurobiology in general, then we can begin to understand healing in a whole different way. And we can begin to feel as if we have some control and some agency around rewiring the brain from the various mood states and anxiety that are not helpful to us. Let's back up one step, and I'll explain this a little bit more. Our autonomic nervous system is basically made up of three distinct components or neural platforms. So number one, we have the sympathetic nervous system, which is related to arousal and activation. It speeds things up in our system. And this can be a good thing. When we wake up in the morning, we want to be alert and we want to have energy. But if we take this platform to an extreme, then we're hitting over-arousal or overactivation, and we're getting into emotional states such as rage or anger or panic or anxiety or extreme stress. An analogy would be to think about a squirrel that's maybe angry because another squirrel stole his stash of nuts. You can imagine the squirrel being very agitated and angry. That's sympathetic over-arousal. When that level of arousal becomes chronic due to something impinging on it, such as fear or worry or anger, chemical imbalance, or even environmental issues of stress or diet and so on, it can be very debilitating to the body and to our neurobiology and to our brain. So I always tell my patients and my clients, we can visit these areas. Just being human, everybody occasionally gets upset. But it's when we live there and our stress becomes chronic that it becomes a problem for our system, our health, and our capacity to heal. One way to remember the sympathetic nervous system is that sympathetic starts with S and speed starts with S. So sympathetic and speed up, it's a good way to remember the sympathetic nervous system. Now, we can't always have the nervous system that is in overactivation. We need another system that will counter this arousal. So in other words, the heart beats and then something needs to happen to slow it down. So we need some contrasting system to have the heart pause or rest. So throughout our entire body, we constantly have this dual process going on where we're inhaling and then exhaling, our heart beats and then it rests, digestion is happening and then it rests. So all through our system, we need activation and we need rest. The contrasting or resting part is what is called the parasympathetic nervous system. A good analogy for this would be a gas pedal and a brake. We can't have the gas pedal on all the time, or we'd be in constant movement, and of course, we would get fatigued. Nor can we have the brake pedal on all the time. We wouldn't get anything done. So we would be in a constant state of rest and pausing with that brake pedal. So we have to have a really good balance between the two. But sometimes what happens is that our system becomes dysregulated because of a variety of influences, such as poor diet or smoking, lifestyle factors, genetics, negative thoughts, any number of things. We can move into overactivation of the sympathetic nervous system or overactivation of the parasympathetic nervous system. So let's talk about the parasympathetic nervous system, which is the braking system or the rest and digest process. So there's two important pieces here. One is that the vagus nerve makes up about 75% of what constitutes the parasympathetic nervous system. The vagus nerve is a very important signaling nerve. It basically wanders through the whole body from the neck down to the pelvic floor. And it touches in on almost all of the major organs, and it helps with signaling to move the organs into rest and digest. The second important thing to know is that the parasympathetic nervous system has two neural platforms called the ventral vagal complex and the dorsal vagal complex. This is important because these platforms, among other things, reflect our emotional and psychological states. And understanding these platforms will enable us to impact on them through specific breathing or mindfulness or yoga techniques that will enable us to bring our system back into balance. So let's examine the dorsal vagal complex of the parasympathetic nervous system. When we're in the extreme of that dorsal vagal activation, we're experiencing things like immobilization, shutdown, disassociation, or clinical depression. So basically, think of an opossum. When they sense danger or they become very frightened, an opossum's defense mechanism is to play dead. And that's fairly similar to what happens when we're in that extreme overactivation of the dorsal vagal complex of the parasympathetic nervous system. We're depressed, we're lethargic, and we just don't have a lot of energy. So on one side of the continuum, we have the sympathetic nervous system. When it is in overactivation, we're experiencing rage or panic or anxiety or chronic stress. The other end of the continuum is the overactivation of the dorsal vagal complex of the parasympathetic nervous system. Here we experience the depression and the lethargy, and we, again, don't have a lot of energy. Either end of this continuum means we're experiencing the release of stress hormones, and our system is not in balance, and we just basically don't feel very good. So I always tell my clients that we can visit these areas, but if we're in a chronic, perpetual state where these platforms are activated on a daily basis, then it becomes a problem to our nervous system, our emotions, and our stress levels. So from each end of the continuum, as we move toward the middle point into more balance, we move into what is called the ventral vagal complex of the parasympathetic nervous system. This is where we start to feel more balanced and centered, more relaxed, and more socially engaged. Basically, if things are working as they should in our nervous system, we have a nice balance between the gas pedal and the brake pedal. But when we have dysregulation of the vagus nerve, It means that we can't relax as well or rest or rejuvenate very well. And it's at that point that we then want to implement specific techniques that bring about some balance and relaxation to the autonomic nervous system as a whole. So just to review, we have three important neural platforms that make up the autonomic nervous system. And this concept fits beautifully into the concepts from Western psychology and from yoga. So if we're looking at this from a yogic perspective, they talk about the idea of the gunas and the importance of balancing the gunas. So guna means quality, and there are three qualities that make up the gunas. These are the rajas quality, and that correlates with the sympathetic nervous system where there's activation. At the other end of the continuum, correlating with the parasympathetic nervous system is the dorsal vagal complex, and in yoga, it's what's called the tamas quality. And then correlating with the ventral vagal complex of the parasympathetic nervous system, in the guna complex, it's called sattvic energy. And that's when the system, again, is more in balance and a person feels more grounded and centered. So if we're looking at this from a Western psychology perspective, then we have three states which correlate to these concepts, which if we're looking at the sympathetic overactivation, the rajasic energy, then we're looking at aggression from a Western perspective. At the other end of the continuum, when we're looking at overactivation of the dorsal vagal complex of the parasympathetic nervous system and tamasic energy, from a Western perspective, we're looking at passivity. And as we move to the center of this continuum, we're looking at the ventral vagal complex of the parasympathetic nervous system, sattvic energy, and what's called assertive energy from a Western psychology perspective. So from all three of these disciplines, psychology, yoga, and neuroscience, we can see how these areas really complement each other and are synergistic in their conceptualizations. So I'd like to share with you a couple of thoughts about the idea of stress. Now, we all experience stress, but what we want to look at is, how does stress get under our skin? What does it do to our brain, our nervous system, and our body? So there are three types of stress. There's positive stress, which is an exhilaration from some kind of challenge. We have a satisfying outcome, a sense of mastery or control. Let's say maybe we accomplished running a marathon. It's been stressful, but we feel good about the end result. The second type of stress is what's called tolerable stress. So we may have had some kind of adverse life events, such as maybe we got fired from a job. But we have good social support and good emotional support, and we have some sense of control over our situation. So we might be okay with getting fired to some degree, and we may have some other options for a job, so it's considered tolerable stress. Now, the third type of stress is what is called toxic or chronic stress, and this is where we feel an absolute lack of control. There are way too many things coming at us, not enough support or comforting moments. And in this situation, we might have poor social and emotional support, so we don't have a soft landing available to us. We also might have a compromised brain structure from a previous life adversity, so our circuitry might get overloaded more easily because of the previous stress that's unresolved. For healing to begin to take place, there are a few things to do to impact on our GM circuits. One, we have to identify our specific areas of stress. Was the stress positive? Was it tolerable? Or was it toxic? When we can identify what's happening, we have the capacity to impact on the issue in a much, much better way. Number two, we also want to ask ourselves, what is the frequency and the intensity of my stress pattern? It's helpful to do this on a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being the highest. You want to ask yourself on this scale, what is my level of anxiety or stress or depression or fear? And three, once we know what level you're at, you can more easily know how to navigate the stress response and make a commitment to bringing it down, let's say from a 9 or a 10 to a 5 or a 6. In psychology, what we say is we have to name it to tame it. When we're working with healing, we have to make a determination of whether we need to upregulate or we need to downregulate. Are we too anxious and aroused? If so, then we have to downregulate. If we're too lethargic and depressed, then we have to upregulate. Lastly, we want to ask ourselves, what dysregulates my physiology and what gets under my skin? We want to take a look at things like our diet, the quality and the quantity of food, and how that's affecting any kind of dysregulation. We want to take a look at also physical activity or movement. Take a look at excess alcohol and smoking and drugs. We also want to look at our circadian rhythms. Is there a disruption in our sleep from shift work or jet lag? What kind of pollution or noise or lack of green space is going on in our lives? What healthy, comforting behaviors can you begin to engage in? Simple things like in the winter, taking a hot bubble bath, or walking in the woods, or planting flowers, or even having a gratitude moment each day. All of these things are going to make a difference in your neural platforms and whether the gas pedal is too hard or the brake pedal is too hard. Again, finding that nice balance between the two. So the takeaway points for today are to think about where you're landing in terms of this neural platform continuum. Overactivation or underactivation? Again, from a psychology point of view, are you in the aggressive range or the passive range or the assertive range? Again, if we're looking at the gunas, are we in the rajasic range or the tamasic range or the sattvic range? When looking at these things on this continuum, an important point to reflect on is for you to determine your levels of consistent anger or anxiety or panic, or if you're just visiting there. That's very important because, like I said, we can visit in these places, but we can't live there. So if we're at this end of the continuum, the dorsal vagal, are you being a people pleaser? Are you shutting down? At this end, are we being aggressive? So the idea is if these patterns are consistent that we're falling into, then the objective is the same no matter what end of the continuum you're at. You want to move towards center point so that we're more activating the neural platform of the ventral vagal complex. Again, the sattvic energy, more balanced, more centered, and has the quality of alert calmness. We're just going to feel better overall when we're in this space. And it contributes to the healing of our nervous system, our emotions, our brain, and our mind. And to also think about these things on a scale of 1 to 10. And this will really help you to set your objective to, in yoga, what we call sankalpa, to set your intention for what you want to do to heal and begin to shift your energy. We know from neuroscience that mental and emotional intentionality can create new neural pathways in the brain. So when we set that intention, our neurobiology and our brain responds. So just having a framework to think about healing is very important. And hopefully this video provided you with that foundation and that framework. So if you found this video helpful, please give me a like and feel free to subscribe. Until next time, I'm Dr. Mala. Please take really good care and namaste.